want to come to you today with some instruction from the Lord. This message today is for born-again believers. And before I get into it, I want to pray because God has a word that is burning in my heart. And I pray that He speaks what He wants to say today because He has some instruction for us that we have been missing. And so, Father God, I just come before You now, here at the beginning. And I know the word You've put in my heart for Your people. Lord, I don't want to mess it up or get in the way. So, Father God, right now in Jesus' name, I pray the Holy Spirit would speak the unction to my lips and to the people because, God, it's time to rise up in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning to you. I just want to come to you with, man, it's not fluff this morning. It's a word from the Lord for His people. And God has been dealing with my heart this morning. He's taken me back to the book of Genesis. And this is a theme that I love so much. As a matter of fact, it's really what the whole book is about that will soon be released that I've written. But God says it's time to teach His people. Because I don't know about you guys, but I am so upset with the enemy. He is wreaking havoc on God's people. And God's people are taking it because God's people do not know what they have, what authority they are to walk in, where they are seated, whose they are. We just don't know so much. So I'm asking God to teach me so that I can begin to walk in these truths and to teach us all. Amen. You guys, I'm like Jesus walking into that temple and throwing over tables. I'm upset. The enemy is invaded long enough, and it's time for us to learn because we can't just have a few people that pray for all of our needs. God wants you to pray for the needs in your life. God wants you to walk in an authority in your own life. It is not to just a few of us to be able to walk in authority and to be able to pray over every need. No, God is calling me to teach because I cannot be, you cannot be, we cannot be the resource for every person. We have to begin to teach the truths of God, that teach the authority of God so that people can rise up in their own life. So I'm going to start with Genesis 3 and verse 1. I was reading this morning and I was already meditating on this truth, and then a dear friend of mine sent me a request of a prayer, and it broke my heart because it's another cancer story, and I hate cancer as I hate all foul spirits, because cancer is a spirit of infirmity that invades. Now, if you don't like that, I'm sorry, but listen, if you receive that, it will set you free because you will no longer see yourself as fighting cancer. Let me give you a revelation right here and now. Praise God. Jesus fought cancer at the whipping post. The Bible says that by His stripes you were healed. You do not battle cancer. Hallelujah. Jesus already battled and won the victory. Now, how do we get it? How do we access it? In Christ is the only place that we can access it. So let's move on. I'm sorry. I was so glad that she sent me that because it spurred the fire that's already been burning in my heart over this word today. Hallelujah. Genesis 3 and 1 says this. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God hath made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? So here we have the entry in the scripture of Satan, him coming. And he came in the form of a serpent. Now listen, now the serpent, that word serpent means this. It means snake, of course, but it comes from the word hiss. It means to whisper a magic evil spell. It means an enchanter. Listen to this part. It means to learn by experience or to diligently observe. So let me pull back the veil on your enemy this morning. His very name, his very character of what he chose for his character to be is to whisper in your ears and to get thoughts in your mind, thoughts of destruction, thoughts of lies that invade your mind. And how does he do it? He sits back and he diligently observes your life and he learns by experience what lies will work on you. and what lies will work on me. I promise you, he studied Eve. I promise you, he knew the right route to get in her mind. That is your enemy today. He is a deceiver from the beginning. He loves to hide and masquerade himself so that you see everything but him. For example, he masquerades as a sickness so that we begin to fight and treat a sickness. Now listen, I'm a registered nurse, so I have no problem with medicine or medical technology. But what I know is this: when you grab a hold of the true authority, and when I grab a hold of the true authority that we have been given through Christ, he is there to heal. He's already done it at the whipping post. He is there to deliver. He's already done it at the cross and the empty tomb. He is there to save. Praise God. Praise God. He's greater than we know. Okay, here we go. So that was that verse. Now it says, now the serpent, which we talked about, was more subtle. What does that word subtle mean? It means crafty, counsel, smooth, or cunning. So the enemy is there waiting and hiding in thoughts to give you crafty counsel. He loves to invade your mind with crafty counsel. That is his end. That is how he comes in. Now, of course, you and I both know what happens. Eve falls for the bait. She takes of the forbidden fruit. She eats it. She gives it to Adam, and there is the fall of man. But I want to rewind just for a minute back to Genesis 1 and 26. Because in Genesis 1 and 26, we see what God's plan was before Adam and Eve messed it up. And y'all, I'm sorry. I'm angry at the enemy today, and I know that the only way I can get him is through releasing the truth. So receive this word today. This is what God says in Genesis 1, 26. And God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness." Here we go. "And let them have dominion," or rulership, or authority over, here we go, "the fish of the sea, the fowl of the air, the cattle, and over the earth." Then God adds this, "Because do you know the Lord God knew about the devil?" Do you know he already knew and gave the plan right here? Here we go. "And over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." Before there was ever the temptation to bow to the serpent and obey his words, God had given Adam and Eve dominion over him. He was a creeping thing. You see how it was divided in that verse? That it says over the fish, over the birds, over the cattle, and over the earth, comma, and over every creeping thing that creepeth. Adam and Eve were given complete authority and dominion over that serpent. But they did not use their authority. Therefore, the serpent came with his lies, invaded, and brought the curse. Praise God. However, I have good news for you today and for me. Praise the Lord. Adam and Eve gave over their authority on the earth to the enemy. And from that point on, the enemy became the prince of the ruler of this air. He became in control and authority in the earth. That is why we saw sickness, murder, death, all of these things that came in, because the enemy was in rulership in the earth. Now, you cannot believe that or not, but the word points to it. God, in his sovereignty, in his all power, majestic state, chose to give Adam and Eve, Adam, rulership in the earth. God chose to give rulership in the earth realm to humanity. God took the power over the earth and put it in man's hands and no longer had it in his hands. Now that may, in your mind, that may make you think I'm trying to paint a picture of a small God. But on the contrary, I'm letting you know that God is so big that he can give power as he wills it. And so he made a choice to put that power and authority in the earth into Adam's hands. So things that happen in the earth, this is for free right here. That's what preachers say. This is for free. everything that happens is not God's will. Stop saying God is in control. When a child dies prematurely, God is not in control. When death and famine invade a nation, God is not in control. God chose to give control to humanity, and humanity chose to give control to Satan in the garden. But I have good news. Hallelujah. Because doesn't the gospel mean good news? Are you ready for it? Here it comes. Praise the Lord. There was a second Adam. Woo! Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The enemy makes me mad, but Jesus makes me happy. So we know Jesus came as the second Adam. He had to be a human being to defeat the devil in the earth. We don't get that. We don't understand. I'm putting my notes down. We don't understand that the reason the demons trembled when they heard Son of Man was because they knew in the earth realm, mankind was given authority over them. And now here we have God who has come in human flesh and is living this perfect life because he is redeeming and restoring authority in the earth to mankind. Hallelujah. There's a book coming about that. But I want to encourage you today, when Jesus came, he came for a purpose. And I believe that purpose was to restore what was in the beginning. And what was in the beginning was mankind in dominion over everything in the earth realm. And that man, Adam and Eve, they were walking with God. And so they were in dominion over the earth, but they were getting direction from heaven, from God. That is what Jesus came to restore. Now, what are we talking about? How do we get rid of the enemy in our life? Praise God. I'm glad you asked. Woo, glory, hallelujah. Over here in Luke 10. Now stay with me, guys. It's good. It's good. It's good. It's going to be amazing because the word is amazing. In Luke 10, the Greek word, which is the same word that was back in the Hebrew for serpent, is used. Do you want to know who was talking about it? It was Jesus. I'm going to read Luke 10 starting, let's see here. Let's just start in 17 and read and see what happens. Jesus is on the earth. He's doing ministry. And it says, hallelujah, hallelujah. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, now, Jesus had sent out some folks, and he had said, I give you authority. And so they went with his authority, and let's see what happens. They returned and saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through your name. Now, listen to Jesus. Oh, Jesus said, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Verse 19. Memorize it, know it, quote it. Luke 10, verse 19. Behold. You see, Jesus said, behold. He said, look. You remember when Satan came in the garden, what did he say to Eve? He said, look. He wanted her to look at that tree. He wanted her to be mesmerized by what was on that tree. He wanted her mind to be taken. And the Bible says she did look, and she began to say, oh, it's pleasant to the eyes. Oh, it's good to make me wise. But Jesus told him to look at something different. Look, I give you power to tread on serpents. Same word, same thought. And scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Jesus came to restore our ability to A, commune with God in the cool of the day, hear his voice clearly, and B, rule in this earthly realm. What are we to be ruling over? We've already been given dominion over the animals. You see that everywhere. We've been given dominion over the earth. I mean, you can look and see what man has done and built and accomplished. But he also says that you've been given dominion over the spiritual realm of the earth, which is the creeping things, scorpions, all of those foul things. Now, what does that look like? Because this is where I just want to really get real. Lord God, lead me. when you get a prognosis of cancer, I hate cancer, so I'm just going to talk about it because it's the biggie that we can't talk about because we have seen people die of it. And so, well, it must have been God's will. I'm going to give you my account. My grandfather died of cancer. His body was shriveled up. He lost all of his weight and died a hard death. That was not God's will. I can confidently say that. What does that mean? Oh my goodness, what are you saying? What am I saying? I am saying that the healing that was given for my grandfather was not received on this earth. Now God is merciful and gracious and awesome, and he is now in heaven. Was he healed when he died? No. God doesn't kill you to heal you. Quit saying this junk that we don't understand, so we just say God needed another angel, or he really need, no, the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy, John 10:10, but Jesus comes for abundant life. If it is not abundant life, it is not Jesus. I'm sorry, it ain't. It is not Jesus if it kills, steals, and destroys. Now, but April, do you think Jesus wants us to live on this earth eternity? Of course we have to die. That's right. Remember what it says in the Psalms? Psalm 91, I believe. With long life, he will satisfy me. When you are at the end of your life and it is your time to go, God's will is for you to be satisfied. It is for you to breathe and exhale, and when you exhale, he receives back your spirit, and you have been satisfied with your life. You have done his will. You have accomplished what he has for you to accomplish, and he receives you back. I do not think that our God, who is almighty, magnificent, most high, has to use the devil's sickness to get you to heaven. Now, we don't hear this. Because we're surrounded by sickness. We're surrounded by these things invading. But it is not God's will. Now, that's the first thing that has to be received. Because if you think it's God's will to kill somebody with a sickness that hurts them and harms them and causes destruction, you're not going to pray for the sick to be healed. You're not going to begin to come against the enemy. And as Jesus said, take authority over him and kick him out. Why would you do that if you don't know it's God's will to heal? Well, I don't want to. If it's not God's will to heal, why do we ever pray for anybody that's sick? I don't. Like, don't you need to hear from him first to make sure it's his will so you're not against him? I don't know, guys. It's a pet peeve of mine when Jesus so clearly in his word paints the picture that you and me are to be an authority over the enemy and that the enemy uses killing, stealing, and destroying. So what does it look like? I'm going to rewind here the last 5 minutes. It looks like this. When you go into the doctor visit or the financial office and they tell you that you're ruined, or sitting down in a relationship and there's defilement there, or something that's killing, stealing, or destroying, that is your moment not to be educated about faith in that moment. That moment is too late. You must be full of faith and the Word of God ahead of time. And so in those places, in those moments of despair, the faith of God rises and you know his will is abundant life. So whatever abundant life looks like in each of those circumstances, guess what you get to do? You get to bring life into the situation. You don't always have to just cast out devils. We do that too, and I love to do it. Praise God. I walk around my house and cast them out of here. When there's strife or bitterness or arguing or anger, whatever, wrath, doubt, fear, you can go on. I just say, spirit of fear, get out. And you know why I do that? Because fear in the Bible is called spirit of fear. Don't believe me? Do you remember the verse that says, God has not given you a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, love, and sound mind. So Jesus called it a spirit. I'm going to call it a spirit. Amen. So I cast them out all the time. We think it has to be some kind of way that it doesn't have to be. Look around your house. See what's invading. What's in your mind? What's in your heart? Let's not just talk about sickness in your body. When you have tormenting thoughts, ding, ding, ding. Remember back in Genesis where it talked about how subtle Satan was, and that word is actually whispers? Kick him out, guys. You have authority. He does not have authority over you. As a matter of fact, he was defeated. Literally, his feet were removed. Remember that back in Genesis? He was defeated. And the Lord said, you won't even have feet just because of what's happened here. I'm going to let this be to all the serpents on the earth as a sign. So when you see a snake or think about a snake here in the earth, it is a sign to you that the spiritual serpent doesn't even have feet anymore. Praise God. God has defeated him. So you don't fight sickness when you've already won. You don't fight. You just execute that victory. You just take the victory that Jesus has already fought. Jesus fought it. You take his victory and you make it your own in Jesus' name, and you execute it. And you say, Satan, in the name, in the authority of Jesus, I command you to get out of my thoughts. I cast down or cast out every imagination that rises up against the knowledge of God. You go into your heart and you say, spirit of depression, spirit of despair, you are not me and I am not you, and I bind you and cast you out in Jesus' name. You guys, it's not so hard because we don't do the work. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Same with sickness, the same with anything. So I want to challenge you today. I know it's running on and on, but man, God does not want his people uneducated about the authority that he purchased for them with his blood, with his life, with tears coming down his face, with his mother watching him be beat, with all of his disciples except for John and maybe a few of the women there at the cross. All the other disciples had abandoned him with the pain in his heart. He was rejected of the Father because he had your sin on him. He was bruised. He was wounded. He did all of that not for you to live mediocre. He did all of that for you to walk in his victory over the enemy, over your own flesh, in this earthly realm. Jesus paid a very high price. And guys, listen, that's why I'm like fiery about this. Because when I think of the cross, when I think of what Jesus did and the price that he paid for you and me to have two things, communion with the Father and authority over the enemy. I want us to have that. I want us to be intimate with the Father. I want us to come before God and worship him and come from a place of being cleansed by the blood, not working to try to reach God. We can't be good enough. We're going to fail. We're going to fall. But because of the blood, the precious, priceless blood of Jesus, we can come to the Father and have relationship. And it's in that place of intimacy that your authority comes up. You cannot rule on the earth unless you're seated in the clouds. That's the book, Seated in the Clouds, Ruling on the Earth. And what it is the two things Jesus bought for you. Intimacy with the Father must come first. Don't go casting out devils if you don't pray. Why? Because you can say the name Jesus, 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 but if the enemy knows if you are in Christ or in yourself saying the name of Christ. So that's a disclaimer that I like to give. You need to get intimate with the Father and pray and read, not because you have to, but because you get to. Jesus made it that way. The people in the Old Testament, they couldn't come before God the Father. They would be stricken dead because of their sin, because he is holy. But you and I walk blameless. We do not walk in sin. Even when we fail, we have an advocate with the Father, which is Jesus. And Jesus takes you and he cleans you every time and he presents you to the Father. You do not have to feel dirty in the name of Jesus, because that is the voice of the condemner or the accuser, Satan. He wants you to feel dirty. Why? Because if he can make you feel dirty, you will not go before the Father boldly. But when you know that you've been cleansed by the blood, which is greater than your sin, you will come boldly before the Father. And why does the devil hate you coming boldly before the Father? Because when you come boldly before the Father, you leave that prayer closet boldly before the devil, because you know that greater is he that is in you than him, than the devil. Greater is he that is in you. But if you don't come to the place of intimacy first, don't try to fight the devil. Matter of fact, I know the scripture says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but there is a wrestle against principalities. A lot of times we preach that verse and we cut it off and we just use it as a verse to not fight against people, which is true, but we leave the other half of the verse alone. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against. We do have a wrestle, and it's not really a fair fight, because you have the blood of Jesus, and you have the name of Jesus, and you have the Spirit of God, and you have the armor of God, and the Word of God, and the blessing of God. Man, the enemy doesn't stand a chance when you know all of that and when you flow in that. So, wow, I love you guys today. I speak over you in Jesus' name that you learn that the Holy Spirit is your greatest prayer partner. Greatest prayer partner. I pray for all of you to be filled with the Holy Ghost in Jesus' name, with the evidence of being a witness, of speaking in unknown tongues, of casting out devils, of laying your hands on the sick and they recover. Mark verse 16, chapter 16, verse 17 and 18. I want you full of fire, full of the Holy Ghost, and praying. And so when sickness comes against you, you go ahead and just come against it, because you already have won through Christ. Oh, praise God, praise God. I want to speak to the ministers for 30 seconds. You are not called to carry every single burden for every single person in prayer. I'm going to challenge you to begin shifting into a season of teaching, because God doesn't want you to fish for people. He wants you to teach them how to fish, teach them the word, teach them the authority they have, because you cannot be their crutch. You will not help them if you are just that place. And also, if you do stay in that role, it will lead to pride, because you will feel like you're the only one that can pray for these things and do these things. But that's not true. It's for each of us who believe. So I bless you in Jesus' name today. Father, I pray blessings over your people. I pray protection that you've already promised. I'm not asking you to protect them. I'm taking your promise that you already gave, and I'm enacting it over them right now, that they'll receive it by faith, that they'll be protected from the enemy, that 1,000 can fall at their side, 10,000 over there on the left side, but it doesn't matter. It won't touch them in Jesus' name. Father God, I pray that authority right now be imparted into their perception. They already have been given authority, but I pray that you'd make them known and let scales fall off eyes today in Jesus' name. I love you, God. I praise you. You're so good. You're so amazing, Lord. Praise God. All righty. Well, I feel better. Do you guys feel better? I'm sorry if that was loud. Just turn the volume down. I love you guys so much. Tag, share, post, whatever. If you know someone that is asking you to pray for them a lot, share this with them. It's time for us to be able to stand in our authority so that we can begin to help others and just multiply this thing. So I love you guys. I praise Jesus, and I declare Jesus is Lord over you today. Stay fiery, y'all. Bye.